Now we will discuss management of impacted teeth. This is one of the most important long essay for undergraduate students, and there are some other short answers like pericoronitis, war lines, lingual split bone technique and dry socket. So by definition, an impacted teeth is any teeth which is prevented from reaching its original position in the oral cavity by soft tissue, bone or obstruction from another teeth. Okay, so say this is first molar, second molar. So this is the occlusal plane. Okay, so impacted teeth fails to reach the occlusal plane in a proper angulation. Okay, it must be upright. Okay, a properly erupted teeth must be upright and it must reach the occlusal plane level. So this impacted teeth fails to reach this occlusal plane. So it will be like this. Okay, it fails to reach the up to the occlusion plane. Then coming to the etiology, there are five theories which explains the etiology behind the impacted teeth. They are first one is orthodontic theory. This is given by Duerbeck. It says that growth of the jaws occur in a forward direction. So any condition which will affect this forward growth will result in impaction of the teeth. Those conditions may be acute fevers, syphilis or tuberculosis and some of the prenatal causes. Okay. Then coming to the second theory, phylogenic theory, this is given by Nodin. Okay, according to this theory, use makes the organ develop better and disuse makes the slow regression of the organ. So due to the changing dietary habits of our modern civilization, we are mostly eating refined foods, refined carbohydrates and soft food. So there is no need to excessive chewing or there is no need of powerful jaw. So as a part of evolution, our jaws getting smaller in size, leaving insufficient room for the mandibular or third molars. Okay, then coming to the third theory, it is Mendelian theory. It says that hereditary is the main criteria deciding impacted teeth. That means if the children get small teeth from one parent and larger or small jaws from one parent and larger teeth from another parent, then they will obviously result in impacted teeth. According to Mendelian theory, hereditary is the most important factor. Then coming to the pathological theory, according to this theory, acute infections or any fevers or syphilis, tuberculosis will affect the bone to condensify. Bone becomes condensified. So there is no elasticity, there is no forward growth of the bone. This is pathological theory. Then coming to the fifth theory, Fifth theory, endocrinological theory. Endocrinal theory. According to this theory, if there is decreased or increased secretion of growth hormone, will ultimately lead to smaller, larger jaws. Okay, if there is decreased growth hormone secretion, that will result in small jaw, that will obviously result in impacted teeth. Apart from these theories, there are some other local factors which determines the impacted teeth. Those local factors are includes decreased space or insufficient space in the jaw for eruption of third molars. Insufficient space, most important thing. Insufficient space. Otherwise, the second one is anything. Cyst and tumors also, if there is cyst and tumors in the bone, then there is no obvious eruption force for the third molars. Then coming to the unresorbable bone. Okay, overlying bone is unresorbable, then there is no eruption of the third molar. Then fourth one is ectopic position of the tooth bud. Okay, from its normal position, it located in other position. Okay, that is ectopic position. So that will obviously result in impacted teeth. Then premature loss of deciduous teeth. These are some local factors which aid in impacted teeth. Then coming to the classification. There are number of classifications for impacted mandibular third molars. But you must write two classifications. Okay. One is Winters classification. Okay, and another is Pell and Gregory's classification. So you must write at least these two classifications, Winters classification and Pell and Gregory's classification. In Winters classification, he given the classification based on the angulation, that is based on the relationship of the long axis of second molar to long axis of third molars. Okay, accordingly, he divided impacted mandibular third molars into 8 categories. That is, mesioangular, then vertical, then distoangular, okay, then horizontal, then buccoangular, and lingoangular, then transverse and inverted. Okay, these 8 categories. Mesioangular is, say, if it is second molar, then the mesioangular impaction will be like this. That means the impacted tooth is angulated mesially. Okay? And mesioangular impactions are the most common impactions occurring in the mandible, because When the tooth erupts, when the mandibular third molar erupts, it follows a mesial inclination. That means from the starting tooth bud position only, it is mesially inclined. That mesial inclination will correct to upright position. It will upright as the tooth erupts. So, any failure to correct in this mesial inclination, failure to upright from this mesial inclination will result in mesioangular impaction. So, mesioangular impactions are the most common impactions seen in the mandible. And the angle, there is something angle, that is, this is the occlusal plane, okay? This is the long axis of third molar. Then this angle. This angle is for mesioangular impactions. It is between 10 degrees to 80 degrees. Okay. This angle between 10 degrees to 80 degrees. Then it is called as mesioangular impactions. Okay. For vertical impaction, this angle ranges from 80 to 100 degrees. Okay, vertical impaction is nothing but this tooth will become somewhat upright. Okay, then distoangular, this angle is above 100 degree. Okay, distoangular impactions are the most difficult impactions. That means they are difficult to remove because their path of exit is into the ramus of the mandible. Okay, one point must be clear here. Mesioangular impactions are the most easiest impaction to do, but they are most damaging impactions because they produce distal pocket to the second molar. Because of the food impaction, they produce distal pocket and root resorption of the second molar. Distoangular impactions are most difficult to do. Okay, mesioangular, then vertical, somewhat upright, then distoangular means the tooth will be like this. Okay, distoangular, this is second molar, distoangular impactions will be like this. Okay, there is simple thing in mesioangular impactions, the distance between the root apices of second molar and third molar will be more. Okay, crowns are closer but roots are apart. In distoangular impactions, crowns are apart but roots are closer. By that way you can identify. Then coming to the horizontal impaction, this angle is between 350 degrees to 10 degrees. Okay, so horizontal impactions is the crown of the impacted tooth is completely horizontal. Okay, like this. It is completely horizontal. Okay, then come to the buccoangular. Buccoangular impactions is the crown of the impacted tooth is located buccally, towards the buccal cortical plate. It is tilted towards buccal side. Okay, simple. Crown is towards the buccal side. Root is towards the lingual side. In lingoangular impactions, the crown is towards the lingual side, root is towards the buccal side. Okay, in transverse impactions is the crown is located lingobuccally, completely horizontal but lingobuccally. There is some simple differentiation between horizontal and transverse. Okay, horizontal is anterior posteriorly located. That means crown is towards the second molar and the root is towards the ramus side. Okay, but in transverse thing, crown is towards the lingual side and root is towards the buccal side, or otherwise vice versa. Okay, but it is located buccolingually. In inverted cases, the crown faces towards the lower part of the mandible. Okay, inverted cases the crown will located towards the lower border. Roots will be seen towards the upper border. Okay, roots are facing oral cavity and crown faces lower border. So this is the winter's classification. Then coming to the second classification, Pell and Gregory's classification. Okay, he divided mandibular third molars based on three categories. Okay, first category is similar to Winter's classification, that is based on angulation, that is similar to Winter's classification. The second category is based on the Ramus relationship. Okay, based on Ramus relationship, he divided mandibular third molars into three class, class 1, 2, 3. Okay, class 1, 2 and 3. Okay, so there are some terminologies we must know before going for these classes. Okay, say this is mandible, this is second molar and this is third molar. Okay, so we must know some terminologies. That is, this one is the anterior border of ramus. Okay, and this is the distal aspect of second molar. Okay, so what we must know here is, from the distal aspect of second molar to anterior border of ramus, so the major distal diameter of third molar, say it is x. Okay, and the space from the distal aspect of second molar and the anterior border of ramus, say it is y. Okay, so in class 1 cases, this y is greater than x. That means there is sufficient space available for eruption of third molar. Okay, in class 1 cases, y is greater than x. Okay, then in class 2 cases, this y is less than x. Y is equal or somewhat less than x. Okay, y is equal, otherwise less than x. In class 3 cases, there is no space available. This y is almost near to 0 or less than half of the space. Okay, this y is almost completely less than the x. That means this impacted tooth is completely located somewhere here. That is into the bone of the ramus. Okay, this is second criteria. First criteria, Winter's classification. Second criteria is ramus relationship. Accordingly, he divided into class 1, class 2 and class 3. So third factor is depth. Okay, depth of the impacted third molar. Okay, he divided in this category like position A, position B and position C. Okay, in position A, the highest portion of the crown of the impacted third molar is in line or above the occlusal plane. Okay, this is the second molar, this is the occlusal plane. Okay, the third molar will be in a line with occlusal plane or above the occlusal plane, say like this. Okay, this is third molar. The highest part is in line with the occlusal plane. Okay, but the angulation is different. The angulation, impacted third molar is not straight, upright. It is angulated. But the highest portion is in line with the occlusal plane. This is position A. The position B is, in position B, the crown of the impacted third molar is in between the occlusal plane and cervical line of the second molar. Okay, this is the occlusal plane and this is the cervical line of the second molar. So crown is located in between this area. below the occlusal plane but above the cervical line. Okay, in position C, the crown is located below the cervical line, below the cervical aspect of the second molar. So these are the three criteria seen in the Pell and Gregory's classification. So in this class 2 and position B, class 2 position B impactions are commonly seen. Okay, then coming to the difficulty indices. Difficulty indices means how much difficulty we may encounter during the removal of impacted third molar. Okay, there are again so many indices which assess the difficulty. Okay, but at least we have to remember at least three indices. That is, first one is Pedersen index, and the second one is Winters war lines. Okay, and third one is war face assessment. These are the three main indices which assess difficulty. Okay, so these difficulty indices are war lines, Winters war lines, can be asked as short answer. So we will make a separate video on these difficulty indices. Okay, we will discuss what are the indications for removal of third molar and what is the exact surgical procedure and some complications in another video. In this video, we discuss definition, etiology, classification, okay, and difficulty indices. Okay, when the long answer question is asked, usually they say definition, classification, indications and surgical procedure and somewhat on dry circuit. Okay, so if you like the video, like, share and subscribe the channel.